So, Bill Ham, I'm super pumped to have you on the show. I can't wait to find out everything about you and your business. I have a little background about you. Welcome to the Capital Raising
Show. Oh, thank you. I appreciate it. Glad to be here.
So, when I was vetting, I've been wanting to do multifamily syndication. I won't talk too much, but I will say I vetted a bunch of different sponsors, right? A bunch of people that taught multifamily syndication. I ended up with my company, Bakerson, because I told them that I raised capital on YouTube. And they're like, what? You actually use social media to raise money? And I said, yeah. So they're like, we want you on board. But in the process of learning about multifamily syndication, I was introduced to Jake and Gino, got on the phone with Josh Rusin, right? And he said, hey, if you come work with us, you'll have Bill Ham as your coach. And I was like, who's Bill Ham? I need to find out who this guy is. You know, I saw you on LinkedIn. I found out that you had, I think it says about 1,000 units that you've done or bought and sold. So why don't we start out with telling the audience a little bit about your background.
Sure. Yeah, I'm in multifamily, and I started off in single family about 15 years ago now. 2005 is when I quit the old job, and I'm a corporate pilot by trade, and that's when I came out of school flying airplanes, and basically realized a pilot is really important during takeoff and landing and not so important on the ground, and I didn't realize that job came with a whole lot of sitting on the ground, not as much flying as you might imagine, and got tired of it. You know, wasn't making tremendous money. I was 28 years old at the time, so it was a good job. And I saw friends of mine flipping houses, and they were flipping one or two houses and making what I was making all year working. And I thought, wait a minute, you know, I was sitting next to those guys at the bar last night. You know, what are they doing I can't do? I thought, you know, these are my peers. And so I studied for about a year, just reading different things and just getting my education together. And my very first deal was a duplex in a pretty bad neighborhood, as a matter of fact. And I had saved up $10,000, all the money I had to my name, and the duplex was cash flowing about $300 a month. And that's what I turned in my 2-week notice on, walked away from the aviation career with a duplex and 10 grand in hand in 05. Went into the recession, that got pretty ugly. Survived that, came out of that, moved into multifamily, and then I've been syndicating and doing multifamily ever since then.
So how many flips did you do before you decided to get into multifamily syndication?
That's a good question. Flips, I probably flipped a good 20 houses or so, 20, 30 houses. I had actually built a portfolio of about 40 single family residences that I was holding as rental. You know, that sounds like a lot of real estate. It really wasn't. I was in middle Georgia, Macon, Georgia at the time. And so those were 40, $20,000 houses, you know, rented out for $500, $600. So not high-end real estate by any stretch. And, you know, that was back when 06, 07, 08. And my friends and I were looking at those houses thinking, gosh, 2-3 years ago, these were $80,000 houses. And we're able to buy them for $20,000. We're geniuses because these houses are going to go back up to $80,000 and we're all getting rich in the next year or two. Now those houses are worth about $12,000 today. So what? They never came back.
Oh my.
Yeah. The old adage, real estate always goes up, is not true. Not true at all.
Okay. So walk us through. I love asking mindset questions. So what's going on in your mind when you realize and you find out about syndication? How did you get involved with it? What did you do to actually get into your first syndication?
Interestingly enough, I had done about a 400 unit portfolio before my first syndication. That's a little known aspect of my story. I was doing real estate in the beginning and through creative financing, mostly doing lease options, seller financing. I would pool aggregate debt from hard money lenders. Basically going in with some form of creativity, taking control of the property, renovating the property, and then refiing at a bank. So I had built a 401 unit portfolio without ever actually walking into a bank and qualifying for a mortgage, at least not for the purchase. I did qualify for mortgages for the refinance. So once I'd done several hundred units, that's when I kind of did my first syndication. It was 152 unit was my first full on proper syndicated deals, a little bit bigger, but I had some experience by that time. So I didn't go from a duplex into a syndicated deal. There was a lot of runway between those two.
So I hear stories like that at the conferences that I go to, right? Somebody goes into syndication, But then you're sitting there as an audience member going, well, that sounds easy conceptually, but I still don't get it. I mean, what did you do? That you had to speak to a lawyer, you had to get all of that paperwork involved. What was that process like for you? What is the person that's getting into syndication gonna actually need to know?
Right. Well, so the basics of it are this. You know, you to qualify for a mortgage, and that's where you got to start, is to figure out sort of what can you qualify for, what can you purchase. So to qualify for a mortgage, you need to have the net worth equal to or greater than the loan amount, plus on average about 10% of the loan amount in cash and liquidity. So the good thing about doing a syndication, or a good thing about sort of net worth, is it doesn't have to be your net worth alone. It can be your net worth plus partners. So the basics of a syndication is going in and bringing on a partner or two, or however you need to bring the net worth to satisfy the lender. Once you have that, you can qualify for your mortgage. But now you're going to need 20-25% down payment. Excuse me. That's where we go out to individual investors. And we have those investors, you know, invest in our deal for 1% of the ownership and 1% of the cash flow. And we're going to use their money for the down payment money. That's sort of the 10,000 foot view of it. You know, so the paperwork is what we call a private placement memorandum, or a PPM. Your attorney is going to create that for you. And what that does is sort of separate what we call the general partners and the limited partners, the GPs and the LPs. The GPs are the people that are putting together the deal, qualifying for the mortgage. They're the ones in control of the deal. The LPs, or limited partners, are passive investors. And so they are not controlling members, but they're not also sharing in the liability. They're not on the mortgage. You know, if something goes wrong, they're only risking the dollar amount they're putting in. So they're limited partners. Now, there's an important aspect to that part of all this. A syndication is just a term that we use. A syndication just means a group of people coming together to accomplish a goal. That doesn't say anything. What we need to understand or ask the question is, are you creating a security or not? If you're creating a security, then in come the SEC laws, Security and Exchange Commission laws, in comes the lawyers, the paperwork, and all that stuff. So you have to ask yourself, are you creating a security? If the answer is yes, then paperwork. And if the answer is no, then you don't have to do the PPM and so forth.
Yeah, so I've actually interviewed a few people. They are very versed in syndication, but they still prefer to this day to take down 100 units plus using a joint venture model or a non-syndication model.
Sure.
What are some of the differences between the two, and do you see benefits one way in your business model that allows you to prefer one over the other in your conversations with your investors? What do you tell them?
They're all good models. Basically, the difference in a joint venture is where everyone is going to more or less have control or have voting rights. And then right there is sort of the line in the sand as to whether you're creating a security or not. And I am not an attorney nor an accountant, so nothing here is considered legal or accounting advice. But if you want a short answer as to whether you're creating a security, look up what is called the Howie test. It's H-O-W-I-E, I believe is how you spell that, Howie test. It's case law from the early 1900s about an orange farmer, and I'll keep the story brief. Basically, that's where the law decided what was and was not a syndication. And short answer is, you know, if you're basically taking possession of someone else's money, but controlling the profit through your efforts, but limiting their control, you're creating a security. And that's basically saying, hey, give me your money. I'm going to do the work. I'm going to fix it up. I'm going to run the project, and I will send you a return on your money, but you're not really going to be a voting member of this deal. That's pretty clearly a security. So that's why we have the private placement memorandum. And that is, you know, can be $10,000 to $15,000 on average just to create that document. So you wouldn't want to go around and sort of do a syndication on a duplex, you know, or create a security there. Probably not enough money. So typically people do them on larger deals. I do them because I go out and raise money from a handful of investors. And, you know, if we have 10, 15 investors in a deal, obviously we can't have everyone sitting in the driver's seat trying to control the deal. So that's why we create the private placement memorandum and syndicate in that regard. I think a JV is easier to do. if you've got a couple of people and you know them, you trust them, you like them, and they have the money, and you all come together and they all have an active role in the deal. They are there for more than just money. They have to have some sort of active role. If that's the case, then I suggest you do a JV. Why not? It's a lot easier. It's cheaper. But again, everybody's an active partner. So that's why people do syndications, at least with the securitized PPM, you know, to limit control.
So when you're raising money for your first syndication, you already have a track record of flipping homes. Did you have to go after an entire new set of investors?
Largely new investors. Some I was able to bring over. But yeah, I'm always out raising money. I'm always out meeting people. I'm always establishing relationships, you know, with investors. I have found, and this is just me personally, but most of my larger partners have not come into my deal until about a 3-year relationship window. So all of my big players, all my big partners, I've always known them for at least 3 years before they wound up actually joining me in a deal. So we're not talking about meeting somebody at the RIA group or at the next you know, networking meeting at the Speed Networking and, you know, they hand you a $100,000 check. That's not likely. I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm just saying it's highly improbable. So anybody out there, if you're looking to syndicate and you're looking to raise money, you really need to be heavy into the networking. And networking is a lot more than just gathering business cards. You know, a stack of business cards, a network does not make. You know, you've got to really follow up. You've got to get to know these people. You've got to establish relationships. Don't think collecting business cards is raising money. It is not.
No, absolutely not. The one thing that you're doing that I'm curious about is you have all of their information. What are you sending them? What system are you using?
So, you know, I follow up on a personal level. I know a lot of people use sort of CRM systems and things of that nature. And unfortunately, I don't have any big sexy answer for that. I keep it personal. I just send emails. I will update people every now and then in the database and kind of say, hey, we're looking at this deal or we're looking at that deal. Just to keep the context warm, you know, if you've got a good database of names, you want to kind of, you know, interact with them on a regular basis. Doing things like you're doing right now, podcast is a great way to stay relevant with your investors. This is a wonderful thing to do. Perhaps a newsletter, you know, I would suggest that. Maybe sending out a market update once a month, once every few weeks. But my network group tends to be closer, so I kind of stay in personal touch with most people. But definitely, you're on the right track. You definitely want to kind of have some sort of follow-up system for maintaining those contacts. I would look for a partner who brings the relationships or brings the credibility or the experience that you need, basically an experienced partner, which that's an easy answer. The real question here is what value would you bring to that individual? And that's something a lot of people come to me and I have a lot of friends and a lot of people that I teach in the business and they say, oh, Bill, we love you. We want to come do a deal with you. And I have to ask, well, what do I need you for? You know, what value do you bring? I mean, I like you, but that's being friends isn't a strong enough reason to go and sign a mortgage with someone. So I think that if this is your first deal or you're listening to this wanting to get into syndication, start with your education. Read, study, learn the market, do everything you can to bring value to a high net worth individual that may not have time to come out and learn multifamily or may not have the time to come out and meet the realtors and network. So realtor relationships is something you can bring a tremendous amount of value to a person. And market, being in a market that's very attractive. I'm in the Atlanta market, so that makes it easier for me, for people that want to be in this area. And education. I think those are your three big areas that you can really create value for a high net worth individual.
Nice. So let me find out about what you got going on. I know that you had mentioned you've done up to 1,000 multifamily units. I'm not sure if those were all multifamily or not.
Not all. Some of that was houses, but mostly multifamily. The bulk of it was apartments.
But you've sold some of them. What is your current business model? What are you trying to do with your business?
Currently, I am looking to be in the B-class space. So B-class meaning your 1985 to 1995 sort of construction, not brand new, not A class, but not C or D, which are your older, more affordable housing products. So trying to stay in the higher quality assets. My thought is if we're going towards a recession, and we are, it's not a matter of if, it's when, if we're going to have the economic market cool off a little, I want to be in sort of nicer properties, not because of the tenants or anything of that nature, but because of repairs and maintenance. I'm afraid that a lot of the product that is built in the 60s and the 70s, a lot of those apartment complexes are getting too old. They're really about to have a lot of capital needs, and a lot of capital expense injection into them in the next 3 to 5 years. And so a lot of the plumbing is starting to go bad in a lot of those properties. And so what I'm envisioning is the next 3 to 5 years, the value in the C space may decline because of all of the repairs that are going to be needed coming soon. You know, if it's built in the 1960s and you're looking at buying it and you ask the seller, how's the plumbing? And they say, oh, it's been great. Watch out, because it hasn't broken. Doesn't mean it isn't about to. It means it's exactly about to, and there's the problem. You know, there's a lot of money going to be spent in the C space going forward. So I'm kind of moving up the food chain, kind of saying the B-class assets, newer assets. So that's my model, syndicate newer properties, and rinse and repeat. That's it.
How long do you hold the properties for?
On average, 3 to 5 years on average. You know, okay. You know, a renovation, a fix and flip in apartments usually takes 2 years. Where it can take a few months in a house, you know, going in and renovating and bringing rents up, stabilizing, and then selling is a, you know, 2-3 year window in most multifamily assets.
And how are you handling the objection if it ever comes up and they say to you, well, I don't know what's going to happen in 3 to 5 years. Maybe this isn't the best time to buy. Why should I invest with you at this time?
Mm-hmm. Well, I can only answer that question from the perspective of multifamily, you know, not stocks and things of that nature, but multifamily is a money-making instrument by design. And that's what I tell house people. Look, you know, a house makes money when you steal it. Apartments make money by design. And so going into a recession, the price, we're only price sensitive twice, when you purchase and when you exit. So in the meantime of the hold, we're just going to sit there in cash flow. So I don't really care what the value does, as long as my loan doesn't come due in that window and I get debt that's usually long debt. You can just sit there and ride out the economy and cash flow. So that's the greatest thing about multifamily, is it's really functionally, it's a business. You're purchasing small businesses every time you buy an apartment complex, but they're businesses that create revenue, cash flow. You just hang on to them and don't sell until the market is up on the other side. So that's kind of the model. That's why I love multifamily. You can hang on to them.
Multifamily is amazing for all of those reasons, for tax benefits and a variety of other things. You go into a property 3 to 7 years down the road, 3 to 5 years down the road. You basically have to sell. What do you do with the profits? Do you reinvest it into a new deal? Do you pay out the investors, bring some of them along with you? What do you tell them at that point, or what should they expect?
All the above. Yep, I've done all the above. So you can do what is called a 1031 exchange, a like-kind exchange, and that's a tax-deferred exchange. So if it's a syndicated deal, you either have to bring all those investors with you to the next deal, or you have to sort of purchase them out, you know, buy their equity out, take control of the LLC or whatever entity to do the tax deferred exchange. There is something called a drop and swap. That's a little complicated. We won't get into that. But if not, then what we do is we just sell and we pay our taxes and we pay off all the investors. They get the returns and we just pay the taxes and that's it.
So the person invests with you and then you reinvest into a deal. What do you think is going to be happening in 5 to 7 years in the market in the multifamily space?
5 to 7, hopefully we're coming out of a recession into the recovery phase. Multifamily should be kind of starting to warm back up a little. Market cycles, usually roughly 10 years apart, you know, from the top to the top or the bottom to the bottom, eight to 10 years or so. So I'm saying, pretty sure we're at the top right now. I thought that 2 years ago and we're still at the top, so hard to say. But I feel reasonable that we're sort of more or less at the top, and that, you know, 5 to 7 is a good hold cycle and we should kind of go through the downturn and up the other side, I'm hoping.
So let's take a step back into your past. You're doing all these creative deals, right? These single family. Tell us some of the creative strategies that you did that maybe the typical fix and flipper or person has not contemplated or was not an expert at that you were able to successfully pull off.
Yeah, I did seller financing. Did a lot of seller financing. That was a lot easier back then. You know, right now the market is hot as it is. There's a lot of options out there, so you won't get as much creativity in the market right now as you will during a downturn. But I did a lot of seller financing. I did a lot of lease options, and I could do a two-day lecture on just how to do lease options alone, so too long to go into it here. But basically, that's a rent-to-own type scenario, just like it is in houses, except in multifamily, we call it a master lease option. And that's a function of going in, renting the property with the right to purchase it someday in the future. And you go ahead and negotiate the purchase price today, and you set that price, and you know you put down some option money. You sort of rent to own, more or less. That's I did a lot of those. And then just borrowed private money. You went in and was able to pool together private funds, debt, and buy those properties, fix them up, and then flip them over to a bank loan. So seller, I did about everything you can think of.
Seller financing is an amazing strategy. I think it's actually better for the seller than it is for the buyer. So you talk to somebody about seller financing their property. Do you think that that's possible in the multifamily space?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely it is. I've done a lease option on a 108 unit apartment complex. Cost me $25,000, and I was able to take over a whole 108 unit apartment complex for 3 years and cash flowed every year. I have gotten seller financing on, I would probably say, about 60% of my multifamily portfolio.
What?
Not always as the primary debt, but in a lot of cases as a carry back. So either from, you know, the seller carrying back a second note to, actually in one case for 152 units, the seller was the financing arm for 2 years. They gave us 80% loan to value. And we actually syndicated, my partner and I syndicated that deal. So we went out and raised money for the down payment, but the seller actually was the lender. They had the property free and clear. And were able to give us financing on that. So yeah, I've done it all.
What was your conversation with the seller there? How did you find the seller? I'm guessing it was off market, right?
It actually wasn't, oddly enough. No, almost all of my deals come through realtors, relationships with realtors. So what I tell people is that it's not necessarily that you're looking for the deal off market. It's really a function of looking for the deal pre-market. And what I mean by that is getting to know the realtor so that when they get the lead, before they push that deal out on the internet, LoopNet, and to everybody in the whole wide world, they pick up the phone, call you because you have a relationship with them, and they say, you know, hey, Bill, Ruben, is this a deal you're interested in? Ride by, take a look, here's the price. If you don't want it, then I'm going to hit the send button, push it out to the internet. So if you have good relationships with your realtors, you can pick those deals up pre-market or somewhat off-market. So this one was actually on the market. Long story, but individual had tried to syndicate it and failed in the syndication. I had made an offer on it about a year and a half before, and they let this buyer tied the property up for about a year, and I had forgot about the property, and a realtor called me up a year later and said, hey, you remember this property over here? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, you want to take another look at it? Okay. Go over, and it was still a good deal, still at the original price that I had offered, and so we were able to pick that up. Where we got seller financing was the seller had allowed this sort of corporate lease. It wasn't exactly a corporate lease, but he was leasing units out to a local behavioral facility that put sort of rehab patients into these units. Mm. And it was great because they were guaranteed revenue. They didn't have to lease the units to the tenant. They leased the units to this company. And that was a wonderful structure for the seller, except they had about 25% of the tenant base rented out to this one company. And that made all of the lenders very uncomfortable. You really don't want to get more than about 10% exposure to any one sort of corporate lease or one company or one, you know, type of demographic in that regard. And so none of the lenders would touch the deal. We were kind of it was in 2010. So the market was still pretty soft. It was Macon, Georgia. Wasn't the strongest financial market in the world. The lenders really just weren't coming to that market. So the only way to get the deal done was to go back to the seller and say, give us seller financing. And so they used the money that we put down, our down payment, they used to pay off their original loan. Therefore, they could give us seller financing. And if somebody has an existing mortgage, they can't technically give you seller financing. So watch out for that. But that's how I did it.
What about on the lender side? A lot of these Fannie Freddie loans, they're assumable, right?
Correct.
Have you assumed any loans this way in the purchase of a property?
I have not assumed any. I have sold an assumable loan, but I've never actually purchased one myself. And I am very familiar with the scenario.
So talk us through that, because a lot of times what we're personally doing is we're doing bridge financing, right? Mm-hmm. But you can go into a multifamily syndication with a long-term loan. And sometimes people say, well, maybe that's not the best strategy unless you really want to hold it for a long time. Because there's going to be prepayment penalties if you sell that property, right?
That's right. Yep. And that's why a loan is assumable, is so that a seller can transfer that loan to the next buyer and avoid that big prepayment penalty. And so that's why loans are assumable. But in a lot of cases, what you're finding is if you're going in to purchase a deal and the loan is assumable, the seller has already consumed the interest-only window. So most loans like that, the first year to 3 years will be interest-only. And so in a lot of cases, the seller has already sort of consumed that interest-only window, and now they're selling it to you, and the numbers may not work out as well. I sold one not too long back where we actually paid just a little over $1 million in prepayment penalty to get out of it. Yeah, but the seller came in and said, hey, look, we will offer you $1 million more if we don't have to assume the mortgage because there's no more interest only. And if we go get interest only, the numbers work better. Or we can pay you $1 million less and assume your mortgage. So it was a wash to us. We just said, okay, fine. So we did pay the $1 million prepayment, but it really kind of flowed through to the seller, or to the buyer. But that was an expensive lesson. I thought we were going to hold the property for about 7 years, and the market just continued to go crazy. And we only wound up holding it for a little over 2 years out of a 10-year mortgage. So our prepayment was quite heavy. To your point, you really don't want to go into a short-term hold with a long-term debt. That's usually a mistake. So depending on what your exit strategy is, if you want to go in and say fix and flip, you know, you're doing some kind of heavy value add renovation, you've got a short-term exit strategy, you want to reconsider that long-term debt because you may wind up giving up a lot of your profit in prepayment.
So at some point you decide to start your own property management company. Why, at what point did that happen, and why did you decide to go in that direction?
I started the property management company very early on. It was really technically a joke. And as I always tell, I've been upwards of about 16 employees at the time. And I always told them, look, the company was originally a joke. It was back when I was doing houses is when I started. I started managing property myself because I was too poor to hire a management company. I didn't have a job. I'd quit the aviation, and I needed every penny that those properties were producing to pay for my ramen noodles. And so I couldn't really afford property management, number one. So one day I just got to thinking, and I said, well, gosh, what if I create a separate LLC and I call this other LLC a management company? Now it's just me and that LLC, and it's just me in the owner LLC. So it's just me and both LLCs. It's kind of stupid, but I thought, hey, let me just call it a management company. And what I'll do is I'll make a lease agreement, a management agreement between both LLCs. And now I can tell the bank, look, I have property management experience. I was basically just making it up. And accidentally turned into a real company 9 years later with real staff, real payroll, real systems. I didn't ever think it was going to turn into something real. And it did. It was just me and two LLCs in the beginning. So it wasn't a real thing at all.
Okay. So one of the reasons I brought that up, because I wanted to segue and transition into potential property management war stories.
Oh, how much time do you have? we'll run out of internet before I get over that conversation. Gosh, I don't even know where to begin. Everything. I fire, flood, blood, I've seen it all. We've seen shootings. We've seen buildings burned down, tornadoes, trees. Oh, I don't know. I mean, what do you want to know? It's too broad of a question. I've seen a lot in 15 years.
No, I'm not sure. Maybe something where you were personally there to witness it.
Let me think of a good one that's not too tough. I would say some of my more crazy stories were early on when I was really in the low-income properties, very, very tough assets. Yeah, I had an individual in one of those neighborhoods sell his water meter. I've had that. So if in the tough areas, people will steal or buy water meters on the black market. And what they're doing is they know when the meter maid is coming, you know, when the meter reader person is coming. And so they put this fake meter in there to get free water until the you know, day out of the month when that meter reader is coming, and they pull it out so that they don't have water. So this individual, I'm pretty sure, was on drugs and sold my water meter. Well, then he decided he didn't have running water, so he didn't need a water heater. So he sold my water heater. And he literally just started selling off parts in the apartment, the cabinets, the toilet. Can't make this up. And I just started to sell off all the parts in my apartment. I've had that happen once. I've had a duplex where the tenant went underneath the house. It was a house converted into a duplex, and it had separate wiring and separate metering. The guy knew just enough about electricity to go under the house and wire the two units back together. So all of a sudden, one tenant starts calling us up after she gets her light bill. It's going, something's wrong. I'm getting this huge electric bill. I don't know what's going on. You know, we go over and look at it, and we're like, nothing wrong. We don't know. You know, she gets another huge electric bill. She's really getting upset this time. And finally, I had to call an electrician out there, and the electrician comes out just shaking his head. He said, you'll never believe this. I said, what? He said, your other tenant here. And by the time we had evicted the other tenant, had rigged the wiring, was stealing her electricity. I had a house where I found an electrical drop cord that sort of came out of the dryer vent. And I thought, what in the world is this? You know, and I go over there and I kind of pull, it's one of those orange extension cords, and I start pulling it. It's buried in the ground coming away from the house that I own. And I start pulling and pulling, and it runs all the way across the yard under the fence to the neighbor's house. My tenant had dropped an extension cord, buried it, and run it all the way over to the neighbor's house and wired their house to our house, stealing their electricity. So, I mean, those are slumlord stories, by the way. So, yeah, I've seen it all, I'll tell you what.
And then, so what's your property management company now doing? It's for the multifamily properties? Have you grown it that big? Correct.
Phoenix Residential Management. Yeah, that's our company, and we just manage down here in the Southeast, in Georgia specifically.
And then on the syndication side, what is your role within your company and who do you work with?
I am the syndicator. I tell everybody I'm sort of the wrench. I'm the guy on the ground that makes it all go around, turn the gears. You know, I go out and bring my partners together. I'm the one that typically finds the deal and kind of brings the people together. And then I'm typically functional and going out and getting the debt and raising the money. So sort of the ringleader, if you want to call it that.
Do you underwrite the deals yourself?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, well, yes. I don't personally do it anymore. I trained my admin manager to be an underwriter. It is still done in-house, yes, but I now have one of my staff that actually does it. So I go out on the internet and I find deals that I like and I send them over to her and say, here, crunch this. And then she sends it back to me analyzed and go from there. But yes, basically we do all our own underwriting.
Okay, so what does a passive investor need to look at before they decide to invest with a syndicator like yourself or myself?
Yeah, I think you need to be comfortable with who the people are. You know, it's large, I would say 80% is probably who the people are, maybe 20% is the actual deal. So be very comfortable with who you're talking to, their track record, their resume, make sure they've done it before. And then read the paperwork, you know, make sure that they can explain the deal to you clearly. But when you get a PPM or you get legal documents, I strongly recommend that you have an attorney or an accountant or, you know, competent counsel on your side, review those documents and explain them to you. Because there is a lot of fine print and you really want to read the documents or have them read to you.
Have you invested passively yourself?
I have not. I always, you know, if I just put my money into my own deals. I haven't had any need to.
Let me ask you this. Do you think the typical passive investor would listen to your advice and actually take those documents to an attorney or invest without doing so?
I certainly hope all of our investors are competent and having their documents reviewed by legal counsel. We certainly tell them to, you know, can't make anybody do anything, but I haven't had any complaints either. So, you know, so far so good, but yeah, we certainly recommend everybody do that. We're not hiding anything. So I want you to go have your attorney read those documents.
So what else I'd like to find out about you is, you know, like, what's your vision? How many units do you want to have?
All of them. no, I don't know. You know, I was a lot more aggressive when I first started than I am now. I like free time and I enjoy my free time. So I value my free time as much as money. So, you know, I like building a portfolio. I like doing business, but not to the point that I have to work too hard. So I try and transact about twice a year. That's my standard goal. If I can do two transactions a year, either purchase or sale, one or the other, but I like to do two turnovers every year if I can help it.
Okay. So let's say that 5 years down the road, you say, hey, I've done enough. You know, I have all this money. I've syndicated plenty of deals, my track record.
I'm not somebody that retires. I'm an entrepreneur by nature, not by choice. And so I'm always going to be doing business to some degree, but I certainly would, you know, work at a comfortable pace. I mean, why do all this just to work as hard as you would anywhere else, right?
Yeah, I think a lot of people will say, well, once I have so much money, then I can travel and et cetera, et cetera.
Sounds boring.
But yeah.
I enjoy business. I derive a lot of my entertainment from business. So, you know, I just enjoy this.
Are you exploring any other businesses down the road?
Not currently. It has crossed my mind. But no, I haven't bought all the apartments yet. There's still a few left I don't own. So I'll keep buying apartments.
All right. Very good. Bill, if somebody wants to get a hold of you and talk to you, are you accessible? What's the best
I am. I'd be happy to give you one. I recommend that everybody go Google, research Bill Ham Real Estate. I'm always trying to get my rank up on the internet. So
yeah,
it's one M, Bill Ham, H-A-M, Real Estate. Type that into Google and you'll help push my rank up a little. Besides that, yeah, I'd be happy to give you my email address. It's bill@phoenixresgroup.com. And that is B-I-L-L at P-H-O-E-N-I-X-R-E-S. group.com. It's bill@phoenixresgroup.com. And there's a piece of business advice for you. Don't pick a company name that's hard to spell. That was a mistake. Yeah, don't pick a company that turns out to be a really long domain or you spend 10 minutes explaining your email every time. So just go ABC LLC 123. You're good. Do that.
Hilarious. It's been a lot of fun having you on here. Tell us a little bit before I let you go. Sure. Where do you get your energy from and how does that?
I don't know. I think I'm hyper by nature, but born ADD, wily ADD. I two cups of coffee in the Wall Street Journal every morning. That's very good.
That's my personal routine. What do you get out of the Wall Street Journal?
Oh, currency, not dollar currency, but staying current in the market. What I find is if you will, one, it's a great education. Two, it keeps you really current on global and local events, and it always gives you something to talk about. You know, no matter what situation you're in, if you're with somebody, you don't know them, you know, you have two choices. You can talk about the weather or what's going on in the world. And so I find I don't really like talking about the weather much. So I can always stay relevant with the conversation if I know what's going on around the globe. So I love the Wall Street Journal. I read it every single morning. I read something about an hour and a half to 2 hours every morning before I get my day started, before breakfast, two cups of coffee and about 2 hours of reading every day.
Man, it's been awesome having you on the show, Bill. Sure. I want to say thank you. I know that I met you at the Jake and Gino and you're like, who is this guy? You know, you didn't know anything about me, but I had had you on my radar as somebody I wanted to have on my show.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming on.
My pleasure.
Hopefully next year we can have you back.
Absolutely. Hopefully next year I'll be looking at your deal.
Yeah, no kidding. Well, we got a deal under contract now and we're growing. So we're finally starting to look outside of Arizona. It's an exciting time. We're trying to manage this. One of the reasons I asked you about what you're doing to stay in front of your customers is that's something that we're trying to implement with our business. But it's been great having you on, man. So
my pleasure.
Thanks again.
Yes, sir. Take care.
With that, we'll sign off. All right. Take care.
Apartments make money by design. Fire, flood, blood, I've seen it all.